Welcome back to If Naruto Had a Twin Sister. I am Dark Shadows. We will get into our recap real fast in a moment. Let's go ahead and get into our intro. Happened last time was Team 10 was just formed with Asuma and Sarutobi as the sensei, with Shikamaru, Naga, Choji Akimichi, Hinata Hyuga, and our favorite Uzumaki twins, Naruto and Selene. And Asuma coming to realize doing a team, seeing if they can work well as a team, was pointless because they were already ganging up on him as a team, so that showed that they were willing to work well with each other. So he wanted to see if they work well with each other even after they released their biggest, darkest secrets, because you gotta be able to trust your teammates with your life. So if you can't trust them with some of your secrets, then yeah, that's what he's thinking. To his surprise, the team let in on their secrets, and they were A-okay with it. Even though they were told about the QB, come to find out, Kurama, and Asuma found an interesting thing that they can be pulled onto the same mental plane as Kurama and Naruto and be able to communicate with the Ninetales. And what shocked them even more is Choji and Hinata were willing to accept Kurama as also part of Team 10. So, according to everyone else, there was only those members. But, according to Team 10, they also had a sixth member. And that was Kurama. And they were all looking forward to it because he had years of experience over Asuma. So they were looking on playing using that battle experience and that knowledge. But on to what happened that night was, as Asuma said, gotta go after he dismissed him, meet him in front of the Archimedes barbecue place. They did. They were all meeting up. You see that first rolled in was twins. Then Shikamaru with Choji. And Hinata following Sharing after with Shino. And Kiba with Akamaru. And Ino followed in slowly. And Sakura came in, acting like, you know, her bitchy Karen self, We're gonna call her the Karen of the Naruto universe. But the new member of Team 7, Hiei, which his family, not really known clan, they don't really see themselves as a clan, even though the rest of the village does, has been known to have either fire or ice. It's very rare for a child to have both, and they're considered a forbidden child and looked down about the members of the clans almost just as bad as a Jinchuriki would be. But they hold a Jinchuriki higher regard to a forbidden child, so he basically was getting ready to move out to Clown Pound because he was seen as dangerous. But the clan was known to be proficient swordsmen, so he mastered that pretty much fast, and he had high speeds naturally, which wasn't unheard of in the clan. But he was already matching, without very much training, matching Guy Sensei's speeds at the when all 8 gates are open. So he's considered one of the fastest people on in the Konoha. I will just say 13 of that generation. So they're talking. Sakura's trying to be her bitchy self, saying we need to go in. And the group reminds her, saying, no, we were told to meet in front of the restaurant, not in the restaurant. If you can't follow these simple instructions, how in the world are you gonna follow orders later on? She huffs and puffs, gets pissy. Finding out that Kakashi was 4 hours late, and did their introduction dislikes, likes and stuff. Hiei sat there and she goes, she does not like you two. And the you two is a Maki twins. I go, Selene goes, being the smart ass she says, she goes, oh god, she has a crush on both of us. Ugh. God help me. That was basically her response. The group laughed. And everyone, I like Sasuke. I don't know why you guys are shocked by this. You guys know this. And Shikamaru offhanded says, and he likes Akamaru's ass, apparently. So, yeah. Which means he's just not gay. He's also into bestiality, and for some reason he has a crush on our poor little Akamaru. So, you do realize, if he comes after Akamaru again, we're all gonna kick his ass, because you know what, we like Akamaru a whole lot more than we like him. She's like, as if you guys can kick Sasuke's ass, he's so much better, that's the whole reason why he's the Rookie of the Year. And Choji goes, isn't that the sucker's title? No one in the class, any that's worth the salt of being a shinobi truly wants that title. The same with the Kunoichi of the Year. And a lot of them nod, yeah. Murmurs go across the group, yeah, they don't want it. Then Team 9 comes walking up. In this scenario, Neji's and Hinata's relationship is not as tense as it is in canon. He still has a hatred towards the main branch, but for some strange reason, in Neji's mind, he does not consider Hinata part of the main branch, based off of how his uncle treated her. He basically treated Hinata like garbage, even a servant before she had a sister, clearly favoring the younger sister, even though Hinata shown that she had monstrous potential, can easily handle herself in a lot of situations if given the proper training. He was just neglectful on her training. So, he took it upon himself to basically help Hinata with her training. When Hinata did not want to adjust the fighting stance, even though he was told by a few sources that the gentle fist fighting stance is a good base, but it does not work for Hinata. She fights the movements too much. And the lower branches, if you want to say, seen Hinata being treated as the way she has. So, basically, the other branches are mainly willing to follow Hinata's lead, because not just the fact that she's gentle, but she has been talking with the other branches and saying that. Branches saying that she's talking with two ceiling masters, and that about seeing if they can get the seal changed where it is a different seal that all of them get. She doesn't see the reason why she couldn't get a seal too, and them, but not something so torturous. The caged bird seal should be used as a punishment, just in case somebody decides they want to go with Itachi on them. And that was usually what the clans referred to after the incident that almost wiped out the Uchiha clan. Down to its few long members. As the Going Itachi. A lot of people in the village referred to that as, oh, you don't want to go Itachi, you don't want to go Itachi. That was just the terminology. So, they were talking amongst themselves, and he was asking how if there's any setup on the new seal. She looks to Celine and she goes, hey, have you been able to work on that the new seal, the seal of the Hyuga? She goes, yeah, but it doesn't go on the forehead, it goes on the wrist. It goes on both of them, and I call it the sinus, the silent sun. It is technically one symbol is the sun and the other one's the moon. As the go on with your yin yang symbol, for your clan symbol. But it comes down to the silent sun. I could implement it on you tomorrow and see if it works. And the only person that would be able to tell us if it's truly working is technically Neji, if he's willing to let me take off the caged bird symbol and put the silent sun. Because I'm thinking two of them will be overdrive, will be too taxing on your chakra networks. I'm thinking that was the reason why the lower branches had the caged bird seal. I look more on it and study it along with my brother and Shikamaru, and we all come to agreement. That's sealing some of your chakra away. Which means when we incidentally opened up Hinata's chakra, your father was already in the process of sealing hers away. Or parts of it away, which means he was preparing her to get the symbol as well. Even before Hinabi was around. Silence came across the group. Neji crunches his fist in anger at more of the main branch. He was going to cast aside in his mind already Hinata. Didn't realize it took some preparation a little bit to, with the caged bird. But if they can break off and they were already thinking about with Hiei and making their own little clan elsewhere. And so they just haven't came up with a new name. They're thinking of Hanageshi, which somewhat translates, I think, to sunset, but it was a symbol of, basically, they're saying the ending of the era. But on to another thing. Their sensei's come outside Kakashi. For some reason, he didn't show up. Sasuke was forced to come by his mother and father, saying he needs to interact with more of his comrades than what's left of the clan. They indulged Itachi when he had these antisocial tendencies. But after the Itachi incident, no. They literally forced Sasuke to go to every birthday party he was invited to, every gathering, and basically forced him to interact with his classmates. And his mom will actually get on to him pretty bad, with extra training to the point he'll collapse if she finds out he's being emo and rude. So he's still somewhat a lot of rudeness, but he holds back because somehow his mother finds out and he's absolutely terrified of his mother. And if she feels, and he's not terrified of his father. His father throwing him through harsh training is okay, but his mother's harsh training is downright sadistic. So yeah, he doesn't want to interfere with that. So they go to basically a gathering place, not too far from it's the Inushikacho where all their clans gather, and they kind of opened it up for the other clans to gather, like when they do like a big gathering. In this case, they did it so they can congratulate the new teams, and they literally had the banner saying, "Congratulations to Team 8, Team 9, and Team 10. Team 9 for surviving your Team 10, and good luck to Team 7. Sweat drop falls across the members of Team 7 because they're not sure what that means and no one is telling them. They're thinking they're still technically a form of a team. Well, the good luck means two different ways with anybody that knows a Kakashi's reputation. He's been known to be a friend killer. He's also been known to have teammates not come back alive the same teammates as he has had beef with. So a lot of people realize if he has he's normally a laid-back shinobi and perverted, openly perverted, running for the title of who's the most perverted than the shinobi in the village, along with Jiraiya. So he's gunning for that title. But mysteriously, if there has been conflict with some team members, wherever, just be going for a mission, it might not be right after that conflict they show up dead. It could be 3 or 4 dangerous missions and they happen to come back, never come back alive. So the adults realize this, and the other jonin truly didn't want Kakashi to be a jonin. Just because of the reputation. He's a damn good ninja. He can complete his missions. They like his motto. And most of the time his team does come back alive. It's just the every now and then. And it's kind of hard to prove that is he setting up that person for death. Because these missions that he has gone on are incredibly dangerous. And the probability of somebody was going to die anyway on the team was pretty damn high. So yeah. that was the main reason why, when the teams were being formed, Naruto was originally supposed to be put on Team 7. But you had enough of the clan heads that were voicing their opinions and downright threats to the clan, the village, saying, "Hey, if you're gonna put him on, you're gonna put any Uzumaki twins on his team, we have a say who goes on to the teams. Normally, we don't have a problem with it. Fine, that works. In this case, we don't want him to be a teacher, but if you're gonna make him be a teacher, we don't want him being their sensei." And finding out that they put Hiei on there, they're not so happy about it. So much so that Ibiki actually goes out of his way and tells Hiei to come see him after team training, because he's going to offer him more training. Everyone knows Kakashi likes to play favorites every now and then. And they're going to kind of play, he's going to kind of play favorites with Sasuke. So much so that he will neglect the other team members. Sasuke has his parents training his ass, so they're not worried that he won't come back. Hiei is a very proficient swordsman and has the speed to make other, when properly trained, can make enemies go running. So basically what he's going to do is have Guy help him train with the taijutsu and bring it up. And somehow, they're going to gather evidence and say, "Hey, he's playing favorites," and convince Hiei to ask for a different sensei. And this is where Guy said he will step up and say he'll take on the extra protege. So, a lot of the teams were being taken care of. The only person that they tried to stop was the Hanno civilian clan from letting their only child go on to that team, but they insisted that it would be good reputation. He has a good reputation, it'd be good for her. Yeah. So they were thinking like civilians, reputation means everything. You don't listen to the whole reputation. So Anko was there helping, and gradually it was a big feast, big barbecue, blah blah blah. Just before they left, Asuma sat there, he was drunk enough at this point, as he seemed, because he did not want to have to tell Hinata this. This is not something he wanted to order, but he kind of looked at Celine and Hinata after being quite buzzed, quite drunk enough, he's been saying that they need to get the chastity seal. This chastity seal was, it was the best terminology to come up with. It meant, and it was basically an anti-rape seal. It prevented from people, an enemy shinobi, from raping them, which could very be the possibility, and now they have a couple of seal masters in the village that can actually do it, and from his understanding knows this particular seal, quote, they can do it. So he told them, "I have set up an appointment at the hospital for you guys to do it. I want it done first thing in the morning." And taking his big swig of basically snatching Shikaku's bottle, whatever you want to call it, was holding his sake and taking a big chug of that. Shikaku didn't make a big deal, because this is also a conversation he did not want to have with me if he had a female team member. And realizing that was the case, he That was it. Kurenai Sensei did not have that problem because her being a female sat there and looked at Ino. Yeah, you're doing that too. Ino, being foolish, was starting to argue, and her father slams, catches everyone's attention. Slams his fist on the table and tells her, "You will do it, or else I'll have you removed as a Kurenichi of Konoha. You will not be going out of this village without one. Do I make myself clear?" Her never seeing her father this angry before, nodded. He goes, "If I ever hear you arguing with your superior officer with anything that actually makes sense, something like this, I'm going to give you to Anko." And she loves fangirls. Everyone has switched up because Anko is not a fan of fangirls. He goes, "Yeah, but Kurenai's a little bit gentler. She doesn't like fangirls either, so I'm actually looking forward to her beating that crap out of you." And he looks at the third Hokage, was enjoying the festivities. He goes, "Look, there, does the sealing masters that we have in the village know the resistance seals and all those that made Minato strong and fast?" And all he did was nod. He sat there and he goes, "Well, can you get me their prices and find out? Because she's getting them. Anything that could get it, she's getting it." By this point, Shino's dad and Kiba's mom heard this and sat there and thought, "Hey, if they know those seals, then let's get them on." Yeah, sure. So, we're by the next morning. Hinata is in the waiting room, kind of shaking, waiting. Never seen Celine late before. Celine comes out of the room that she was in with Shikamaru, and basically there comes out and she blushes. So she has her moments where she does blush beet red to find out what's going on. And she assumed what was going on, and he goes, "Okay, I'll wait out here for you guys." And she motions Hinata to follow her, and tells Hinata to basically strip down to your waist. This is how it's going to be. And Hinata, being somewhat uncomfortable, but having Kurenai Sensei and Yoshi there, Shikaku's mom, or Shikamaru's mom, not Shikaku, Shikaku's wife there, was actually reassuring that they were there, and sat there, blushes a little bit of embarrassment, assuming that Shikamaru and Celine did something naughty, because she kind of walked out a little, looks like a little stiff and stuff, and a little red in the face. So all the indications in her mind that they did something naughty in the room before us, she got pulled in there. No. Now she realized there's two adult females in there. Didn't realize that Anko was there, because Anko is one of the supervising people that has to be there. And after, it didn't take long with the seal being placed right by the cervix, and she felt a little bit of the foreign chakra activate, and she explains that what it is. And then as Hinata's getting dressed, she kind of looks at her and she goes, "What was the Lord Yukimaru was talking about the resistance seals and stuff. Selene goes and explains the resistance seals, there's different stages. Her and her brother and Shikamaru has come up with another one. If anybody's seen the, we're going on a side note, anybody's seen the Yu Yu Hakusho, when Genkai does those little resistant things on Yusuke? Yeah, that's basically what she's going, they developed. And she goes, we also developed another type of seal, which takes, will help make your chakra grow a little faster, but it's almost like the thousand healing seal on that Tsunade has. But for us girls, I can make it so it looks like a nice cute little symbol, like we, like in my case, I had a cute little fan type deal placed on there. I could have something similar. We can change the color. For the guys, they just prefer a red dot. Shikamaru is more of a green dot. And no one truly paid attention to it. But he goes, it doesn't necessarily need to be on the forehead. I kind of figure, well, if I'm going to have something decorative, I'm going to put it on my, it's not really decorative, but I'm going to make it look decorative. For Shikamaru, instead of the green dot, he had green, almost looks like a green tattoo, dark green tattoo, with his clan symbol and deer on there. I placed on his shoulder and shoulder blade, kind of stretching out there. And it looks like the shadows starting to wrap around, coming out from the symbol, his clan symbol. Naruto had the basically leaf symbol placed on his shoulder with the flames around it that represent the leaf's will of fire. And he had the flames look different colors for the different colors that represent the different clans in the village. So she was talking about that. And Hinata goes, well, how much will you guys charge? She goes, for you, we'll do it for free. For Choji, we'll do it for free. For Ino, it's going to be, depending on per resistant seal and what her father wants, it will be ranging from a B rank, A rank, to S rank mission cost. Anko kind of whistles in the corner. Damn. He's looking over the seals now. The Hokage is covering these seals that was placed on. So for every female that we have this placed on, this we get the cost about a B rank. And Anka goes, whistles in the corner saying, damn, you guys can you can clean out. She goes, well, me and Shikamaru and Naruto can clean out pretty damn well, yeah. And we can speak through Naruto's down the hall doing his clients. And Shikamaru quickly did me, and then he's gonna go start his list. We have a big list that we have to get through before 10 o'clock. Hinata nods. And she leaves the room, and everything's quickly cleaned up and changed, like, you know, at a normal hospital visit. And sitting out in the, on the chairs is Sakura Haruno and her mother. Kakashi, there was a message from Kakashi saying that he will order, the third has sent out a message throughout the village to all the female men from getting to on up that hasn't had these seals yet go and the place he's not having, and he made quite clear the Hokage has ordered that no female is leaving the village until it's done. So after Hinata was done, because they had scheduled, Asuma made sure that both of them were scheduled quite early. Once he made them form Team 10, he scheduled to have them have the sealings done. Sakura and her mom were sitting out on the deal. They never made a schedule, so they just, it's just come, they will get served whenever they get served. And considering she had three other people ahead of her, and Ino being one of them, yeah. She goes outside, she calls for the person, it was an older woman with long purplish hair, and she was wearing the jonin getup, but you could tell that she was possibly Anbu. Comes in, same process before with Hinata, quickly in and out. Ino comes in, she calls in. Ino's pretty fight, but her mom, being a former nin herself, dragged her ass in there and forced her on there. And then asked if, are you going to put the resistance seals on now? And she goes, I could. So they already had her, Ino stripped down. So once she had the chastity seal placed on, then she shows Ino, asks Ino's mom about this one. It's basically, it's a special type of sealing, almost like they explains it to her, that it seals away about half the chakra of the user away at once, and about a quarter of it every single day. Unless they're doing missions or training and stuff, it can range from a quarter to half, blah blah blah. But it's to help build up the chakra reserves faster and safer. And she nods her head. She goes, keep in mind, this also means that she's prone to more easily to chakra exhaustion. And she nods. She goes, understood. Well, let's go ahead and do it. And she's reading through some of these other. She goes, put them all on. He wants them all. Whatever you can do, he does not want to hesitate. He wants to do it. And she nods her head. She goes, she looks at Ino. She goes, do you want it on the forehead? Kind of like a diamond shape? A dot? Or do you want something like me and Hinata have done? We're going to do and put like almost like a cute little flowery fanning out type deal. Like the lotus flower fanning out. And being a petty, a shallow person, she was worried about her look, so she didn't want that symbol easily found. So what they ended up doing, what Celine does with her chakra, was making the seal and making it look like the Yukimura clan seal with the flower. And then she goes, puts on the resistance seals, then has Ino dress, and then she goes, before she left, as she steps, she goes, what about the other one? No, this is going to be it right now. No, we're gonna step outside before you leave, because I can't have you in here holding up my office. I got other people to do. And her mom understood, and when they walked out, she goes, Ino, turn around, hold your hands up. And You can see almost a little red, blue ball. Looks like a pure chakra energy and stuff. Form on the other fingertips, like almost like a kanji seal, but the chakra was there. And you, she goes, do you wrap it around the arms like it. You can literally see as she's going around the wrist. You almost see like it looks like a glowing blue wristbands go across the wrist and go around. And then she does it around the legs. And she writes a note to her mom, and yeah, basically, Kurenai Sensei basically telling her the safety word, which was the will of fire. And Naz did not want to give that to Ino because Ino right now is short-sighted, only thinks of the here and now, doesn't think of much anything else. And so she basically has about, give or take, 500 pounds of weight on each arm and leg. And Ino basically goes down like a ton of bricks, can't move. Is struggling to move, and starting to bitch out, and when Celine goes, are you fucking done? Now shut the fuck up. If you want so much as pick your fucking ass, you will have to be forced to channel chakra through your arms and legs just to move. Or you can stay the fuck there, but no one will be able to lift you because each leg has about 500 pounds of weight. Each arm has about that too. She goes, I think even Guy Sensei will have a hard time opening up, getting you off the floor. So, yeah, that's the reason why I didn't want to do that in there, because, well, I knew you were going to drop, and it would be safer for you to drop out here, because I didn't want you cracking your head open, and I had to keel it. And I also need that room. So, guess what? And calling for, just as she was about to call for her next person, Sakura's mom jumps up. She goes, she's next. We've been waiting out here patiently. And she kind of laying her bitch out and sat there and go, and she kind of looked, did you make an appointment? And she was taken back. She goes, well, no, the Hokage ordered. Yes, the Hokage had ordered this. But, there's only 3 of us here, and there's about a village of over 1,000 people, we have about, what, give or take 250, maybe a little bit more, of females having to get the seal. There's only 3 of us. We only can do so much in a day. But, considering you insist on a female doing this, you did not make an appointment. You just said you wanted me, a female. So, considering you just said no, you didn't make an appointment, well, in this case, it's first come, first serve, and she's technically the first to come and sit here. So she will be served, but I have 2 other appointments. And I better get them on time because they're active shinobi. Koichi's. And I don't want to be holding them up on any missions. That's when Sakura jumps up and says, I'm a Koichi too. I'm technically active. Yeah. You know what, you're not the active type of shinobi that needs to be out there in the field. Are you working? Celine kind of looks at her. She goes, I am out in the field. We were going to do a mission today, but you're going to make me late for that. We don't do this. Uh-huh. So, you're doing a C, right? No. Are you doing a B, right, to mission today? And she goes, no, I don't know what rank. Okay, the girls that I'm trying to get out here are slotted today to do a both B, A, or S rank missions, and I'm trying to get them out as fast as they could. But the missions you have, you don't even know the missions, and it's considering we're just freshly graduating Ganin, we're most likely going to be doing D rank, and as far as I know, according to the roster, Team 7 is not active completely yet. So, yeah. It wouldn't be so boisterous. So, as soon as I get these two, they won't take more than 5 minutes each. Well, not each, but 5 minutes to get them done. Then I'll get you, and then you can get on your way. Sakura's mom grabs her by the arm. You listen here, you little demon bitch. You will get my daughter done now. Not yesterday, not 5 minutes from now, not 10 minutes from now. You're going to do it now. Or else I'm going to make a complaint to the Hokage. By this point, Kurenai has come out. A few other people have come out. The nurses have come out because they've been basically cleaning up after each person. So, there's this big witness of everyone there. They just witnessed this whole deal. And they're all shocked. That's when Celine kind of looked at her and sat there and she goes, yeah, I'm not getting paid enough for this. Until further notice, she reaches yanks her arm away from Sakura's mom and goes over and yanks the headband off of her Sakura's head, excuse me. Sakura's head. And hands and tosses it to Ino. Until further notice, the Hokage has ordered that she gets this symbol before she can go out into the field. The ceiling. And because considering that I am refusing as of right now to basically do the ceiling. And that basically disqualifies her being Koichi. So, and I don't know about me and my brother and Shikamaru, but we will not be agreeing to the set price that we would with everyone else. You will pay S rank. And we will call, one of us will call you when we're damn well ready. And as it stands right now, I can see she's barely holding herself up. She doesn't have the chakra reserves barely than the civilian. So I cannot, within good conscience, without doing a full physical, agree to let her go out into the field. Or just stay in the village and do stupid rank missions. Sakura's mom gets really pissed and starts becoming angry and she sat there. She goes, you have no authority. That's when she goes, bitch, in this case I have all the authority. I have all the power. You don't, I do. I had just made the decision. I will file the paperwork as soon as I'm done here, and your daughter will be taken off the active duty. So, if you want to continue to make this trouble, I will end her career right now before it's even started. And being a medical ninja, I have that power. Medical ninjas have the final say. If I do not think she is prepared or ready for the field, the only way right now she can get back into the career is she has to go back to the academy. I wonder how Sasuke will think of that. Now get the fuck out of my face. And get the hell out of my hospital. And as she calls in, that was basically the day. Once she did that, she had already pre-filed everyone's paperwork. So she's finishing up the paperwork to basically saying that the Sakura refused to get the seal. There was witnesses. And she goes from any other available seal master that was there. Insisted they have female, but when she would not wait her turn, because they outright demanded, because it was first come, first serve, she never made the appointment to do so. Yeah. And as she walks up to the Hokage Tower, as she's walking up the steps, Kakashi's walking down, and he sees a headband on a stack of paperwork. He goes to reach it, because by his sense of smell, highly advanced as a canine, he smells that the scent of Sakura's on there. He goes to snatch it, but before he can snatch it, somebody snatches it from, keeps him from going from his hand, and she goes, can I help you? Or do you just feel like snatching things off of people's paperwork just for the hell of it? Because I know you're one of the village's biggest pervs, but if this is your way to get a pickup line, and I'm only 13... Yeah, this is born on pedophilia. So, are you becoming Orochimaru as well? Because we all know he has a thing for the kids. Kakashi kind of looked at her and she sat there. He goes, I was just wondering why I was going to grab my student's headband and walk back. He give her back to her tomorrow. As he's going, he doesn't realize the death glare that was being placed on him. She took your test. He goes, yeah, they passed. The test was not supposed to be given now. What do you mean? For some reason, she didn't have her hit die, and I asked her why, and she sat there and told me that the bitch at the hospital took it. And she was gonna get another one later on. Yeah, I'm the bitch. And there's a fucking reason. Now get out of my fucking face. Team 7 is not acting as far as I'm concerned. You might have passed your students. Against a medic's orders. Do you make it a habit to go against medic's orders? Or you're just that fucking stupid? And she walks, Esselin walks away, hands off, up to the steps, leaving a stupefied Kakashi. He's never been talked that down to like that. And the look that she had was the same look that Minato had given to people that made you feel stupid. That look that made you feel stupid without realizing it. Yeah, she had mastered that to a deadly accuracy, even more so than his sensei. He was actually questioning her judgment, because when she basically cursed him out and yelled at him for being, and then realized and accused him for being pedophilia, borderline paraphilia, so thinking that he was hitting on her. He was just shocked. He did not have time. He was trying to process what just happened. So he turns around to go back up to find out what the heck is going on. And as he goes in, he sees Sakura's mom is raging a fit at the Hokage. And the Hokage is kind of standing there, or sitting there, should I say, at his desk. Kind of looking like he's not really paying attention to what the hell she's saying. And he's just basically reading over the file. And he's lifting up the paperwork and stuff. He's looking and saying, oh, okay, this is it. And he goes, and calmly, while he's reading he sees the Hokage reading the paperwork, nodding his head. He sees Celine not too far from behind the Hokage, having a chat with Anko, and looking like a borders haver and stuff. They're not having the understanding what's going on. And she's just raging. And finally, when she's done raging, he goes, was there a reason why you couldn't wait your turn? She had a Kakashi, her sensei Kakashi, told him to be at the training grounds seven at 5 o'clock. Well, I told him we'll get a doctor's note. This needs to be done. The Hokage's ordered it, and it was going on 9 o'clock in the morning. And the third goes, you could have not made an appointment prior. And actually, she could not have gone. Just because she was a Genin, we weren't sure if she was going into the corpse or not, or being sent back to the academy, which having the seal was she putting her step ahead of everyone else, but not necessarily at that point. And her mom goes, I ordered it. But it comes down to the senseis to go ahead to make the appointments like the individual departments that have their females and do a count that don't have it to go ahead and make the schedule. That is just easier. If you decide to go on your own and just stuff, like some other females that got the order, or heard the order, did not have the appointment, you basically had to wait your turn, and she wanted to get through the appointments before she get to you. Well, that was fine. And it ever occurred to you guys to just go ahead and make the appointment for later on that day. She goes, well, we were there. There was not that many. Why couldn't you? She goes, I'm not making the rules when it comes to this. They set it up. This is how it was. They would do the walk-ins, but they were going to get past the appointments. And regardless if they had the appointment, if it became to a high-ranking Konoichi that was due to go out on a mission today or tomorrow, they were going to go ahead and get through them first. So even though Ino and Hinata had their appointments set up prior by their senseis, and they did it early enough that it would not have not affect any other Koiwichis, they went ahead and got it. So and she kind of was stupefied and walked out. Kakashi stepped aside and let her walk. That basically, she realizes that Hokage wasn't going to budge on this. He was going to stand by the Konoichi that did this. And basically could not refute the argument by saying, well, we could have easily done it, or just waited more of her turn, showing that she was being a little bit more impatient on this. And realizing now she has to pay for an S-rank mission. So she's going to the missions desk to pay for that so Sakura can get it done. And Kakashi had it set up the next day for Sakura to get it done. But the missions desk kind of looked at it because they got paperwork until further notice, until the Hokage could do something, or they were going to talk about it, or something. They thought it was weird that he was making an appointment for Sakura Haruno to get the ceiling, when they, about 4 hours prior, got the, had a nurse run over with paperwork that is currently with the Hokage, basically saying that the medic plus the ceiling master that was looking is basically disqualifying Sakura to being part of the shinobi program. So after having gained the strange looks at the mission desk and everything, some of the pieces are starting to place themselves together after that he just witnessed that whole incident. And he's standing there, he hasn't been acknowledged by the Hokage yet, and the Hokage kind of looks, turns around in his chair and kind of looks at her and goes, "You really think this is necessary?" He goes, "I agree that they need to pay you more for just the hassle. And I also understand that they all, it's considered they jumped the gun considering that I just placed the order this morning." So, not 100% sure how they got that order yet, but, yeah. If Kakashi has no problem dealing with a crappy ass Konoichi, he's probably gonna die in the field anyway. Yeah, I'll reinstate her once I put the seal on her. But it's his responsibility to teach her the proper diet and beat the crap out of that idiotic civilian thinking. The third nod his head and had to agree on that one. So he sat there. And she goes, "But I'm standing by my decision. Also, the fact that he tried to take her headband back doesn't show he's going to respect my decision anyway. So, you know what? I'll let you deal with him. Bye." So she takes off and shimmies out of there. Anko kind of had to laugh because she's somewhat recounting what happened in the hospital. In agreement, he understands that one of his ceiling masters just got insulted. So he finally acknowledges Kakashi. Kakashi's sister goes, "Do all your respect to Hokage, but why are you letting a genin who's just graduated from the academy, who literally is pretty much on the, might as well, almost the dead last of her class. And with the girl she's about, with the Koiwichis that are there, she's pretty much the dead last that passed their test." The third kind of raises his brow and sat there and goes, "You do realize she's a ceiling master, right?" He goes, "Yeah, you do realize she's a fully trained medic who's on par with her medical ninjutsu with Tsunade." He goes, "And she's learned the veterinarian side of medical ninjutsu to be able to treat your canines in the field if it was necessary. Kakashi kind of said. So, when it comes to her judgment, I will take that judgment. If she says that Sakura is not ready, Sakura's not ready. But if you want to take on that shit show, by all means. You can take on the shit show. But don't come crying to me when my sealing master and my medic slash medic wanted to disqualify her from the ninja program. Send her back to the academy already. But you think she has potential and she can do shit? Fine. It's your job to knock that fangirlism out of her. So, guess what? You can do that. It's your job. You want that? You can have it. And basically, Flick is a hand showing that he dismissed Kakashi out of that deal. So, basically, we're going to time skip to the next morning. Sakura's all smug. Thinking that she's going to schedule her time. A sealing master to put through chastity. Well, she didn't get the person she wanted. She wanted to rub it in her face. Kakashi was standing there waiting to make sure it got done. Coming out basically in a black, almost doctor outfit or coat. The sleeves rolled up. Him wearing, he had his headband wrapped around the shoulders. Is Naruto sit there and go, Sakura Hano, get in here. Let's get this over with. Sakura eyes went big and throws a huge fit. I didn't put my appointment with you. He goes, no, Kakashi deals with the appointment. And then he didn't specifically ask which sealing master. He just said master. So they gotta go with the person that has the time at this time. Which is me. Now get your ass in here so we can get this fucking shit show on the road. Kakashi kind of looked at the young Genin and told him, you will not speak to her in that way. He goes, I'll speak to her however I fit. She's been talking shit about me this whole time. And she thinks I have a crush on her. I don't have a crush on her. I don't like her. Maybe if I start treating her like worse than crap, she might get it through her fucking head that I don't like her. But it's not me that's going to perform it. I'm just calling the person in. All the sealing masters with this one side, we're all going to be here watching. We're covering our asses. With that, Kakashi glares at Naruto, not liking his tone. So, saying a little killing intent, and Naruto kind of rolls his eyes and flips him off. Oh, really? Uncle, who has just arrived, to say with Ibiki, saying they're giggling or chuckling, and Sakura, when she walked in, she couldn't be more embarrassed. Ibiki was there from Shikaku. Uncle came walking in. Aruka Sensei. Anybody that was holding a department head, basically in that moment was asked to come. She sat there and was embarrassed. Okay, Sakura, I need you to strip down from your waist on down. When she looked and saw it was Selene there that was telling her to do that, and the boys kind of had their Nah. She goes, I'm not doing anything while you're here. You do the seal now, or we're not doing it, and I'll still disqualify you being a shinobi. With everyone here witnessing that you refuse it, there's nothing, not even the strings of your sensei can pull this shit. This is your one and only chance. So if you want to be disqualified from the program altogether, fine by me. I still get paid either way. Chuckles rolled through the room. Kakashi sat there and glared at Celine. He goes, you will mind your tongue. I will mind nothing. And you shut the fuck up. You're already on the shit list. Do you want to be on number one? The chuckles even got louder. Now, strip down to your waist on down and get on the fucking bed, put your legs in the stirrups, and let's get this shit show on the way. I am not going to... You have about 3 minutes to do this. I am not waiting any longer. Sakura was sweating, about to argue. 2 seconds and 95 seconds. 2 minutes and 95 seconds. Realizing this was actually being a quick thing, deciding not to push it, Sakura quickly does what she needs. Gets on there, realizing that a sheet has been placed over her lap, so even though she's covered, next you know, they see a light glowing, they thought deal, and she feels a slight pressure by, because of the seal being placed by her cervix. Quickly done and out. Celine gets out from underneath the sheet and basically tells her to get dressed and get, and as she quickly washes her hands. Then she turns around and hands her a bunch of pamphlets and orders. I go, if you want to continue to be in this career, you gotta drop that diet right here, right now. That's not doing you good. She goes and starts explaining how it's putting too much stress on her Sakura's chakra networks by this dieting. And she keeps up with this. She will not be able to have children. And could put herself more at risk by doing this. So she hands her all the information. Hands her the information for a proper diet and tells her to get the fuck out of her medical office. She has things to do and she's not gonna waste a damn thing. More time on a freaking airhead that should know some of this stuff already. Before Kakashi, after Sakura left, before Kakashi can leave, he goes to tries to grab Celine to intimidate her. She has him on his face, planted on the ground so fast with a kunai in his back, saying, you try to touch me like that again, there'll be one less shinobi in this village. And I don't think anybody truly miss you, besides maybe Guy. But I think he'll get over it pretty damn fast once we find him a new eternal rival. Now, get the fuck out of my office. If you don't mind, have a nice day, he says in a nice, sweetly voice. Kashi just gets out. He's not 100% sure what just happened. He goes to grab her, and next thing he knows, he's basically kissing the floor. And he's kissing it quite painfully. And he can still feel the kunai between his shoulder blades, right where the heart was. So, if he made a move, that was a quick death. She was willing to provide him a quick death. He quickly realized the smart thing to do was not to piss off that particular female. She is showing that she is quite a deadly koichi, even at the young level that she's at. But maybe what he can do is kind of direct Sasuke into choosing that strong female to be his bride. So he's already starting to set up a Sasuke to be obsessed over a certain female. That poor Celine. I think she made it quite clear she does not see Sasuke in that way at all. But going on to the D-rank missions. Between the D-rank missions and the training, they're into their first week of being part of Team 10. So they got into a comfortable training routine. Hinata and Choji realizing with Asuma, realizing that the three of them will actually wake up at 5, about 4:30, be out by 5 o'clock and start training, running around the village. And they call it freestyling running. So, where they're running through they jump through obstacles. They don't take a normal path. They actually try to find the most the most resistant path ever, and then try to beat each other's time. And it was quite difficult for Hinata because she was used to running pretty good, but now with the resistance seals and her everything, she just felt a little bit more exhausted, but she could tell by just a week into this, she's feeling stronger. She knows when these things come down, she'll be a whole lot faster. Probably not as fast as the Uzumaki twins, but yeah, Hiei even came and asked for the resistance seals and stuff, and he got a pretty much awesome tattoo. They decided to put a dragon tattoo to show that they can do unique deals with this particular ceiling. And he thought it was just awesome play. He got black flame dragons rolling around up and down his arm. Oh, he loves it. He's thinking of getting a matching one. And they said they could actually make that one more like a Fuji seal, where it can absorb somebody else's chakra nature. He can add a little bit of chakra into it and then send it back. He thought it was a useful thing, so he did it. And he asked them to go with the getting the special metal and stuff. They actually made him a special katana with able to do something similar. And with the finding the first one of the first Hokage's trees and taking out one of the roots, they were able to make a beautiful sheath to go with it. So he was quite happy with it. He had this beautiful black sheath that was, oh, and what made it really nice is that they put a knife sharpening deal down the center where the blade goes in the wood. So every time he's pulling in and out, it's helping sharpening that. They had designed it so the sheath will help sharpen the katana, even though he's known to take very good care of that sword, like it's his baby. It's his prey and joy. So with that, Asuma said he wanted those resistance seals too, and that chakra storing thing. He realizes that he might be with it all, might go down to a high tuning, maybe a low joning, but he thought it was a good idea to set an example for his students. So by all said and done, by everything done, he had the resistance, he had all the resistance seals, and his chakra storing seal actually resembled a monkey and a monk stance, fighting stance. He actually liked it. He thought it was cool, made him feel badass. So by this point, by the end of basically 2 weeks, all of Team 10 has all the resistance seals. Choji basically has a giant, has a blue butterfly on his shoulder with flames. So it's kind of cutesy, but it's cool. They made it look badass. So he has all the resistance seals. Asuma has all the resistance seals. So basically, we already know Naruto and Shikamaru and Selene have those seals. They had them on for years. They made them stronger every time in the academy to help them hide the fact of what they were. So when if the seals finally come down, they could probably take on somebody like Orochimaru if they tag team. They're not 100% sure. They're not looking to test it out anytime soon. It's just a theory. So, with that, and Hiei is the only member of Team 7 that doesn't ha is the only member of Team 7 that has them. The other two don't, or including Kakashi. All Team 8 has it. Guy heard overheard the Kunai and Asuma talking about it. Kunai got hers, and she looks like her ceiling chakra ceiling thing looks like a mirage moving into cherry petals. But yeah, for Kiba, his chakra ceiling looking like cool badass tattoo is basically he does like a one of his they got one they did like a black wolf with blue looks like blue glowing eyes on his shoulder. And Shino, they basically did the Hercules beetle type deal with the clan's symbol on one part of the beetle shell and the other shell, the hidden leaf symbol. So they all have that. So they all Guy overheard it because he's looking to try to improve his team, and he brought it up to his team. They thought that was a good idea, so they go look and ask for the prices. Well, 1010 can't really flat out pay that price, but she does offer a trade since her family, excuse me, owns a weapon shop, a high quality weapon shop. She offers, with her permission from her father, a trade of high quality weapons if they do this. And it's basically they have a year, over a year supply or a couple year supplies of kunai, shuriken, the basics, and they're able to get their specialty weapons off made. Because the father looked at the price and he goes, "Yeah, this to get all these, it's just it'll cost a few years worth of weapons." So they went ahead and agreed to do that. It was just cheaper to do it that way than. So they agreed on that. And so, and Neji, who's been saving up money for years and had a small inheritance from his father, and he was able to get it. Guy Sensei, knowing Lee could not afford the prices, discussed with him a trade-off in the end. You see, it was basically he will supply them more weapons and stuff. And he'll pay for half of it, and the other half he will get more weapons. And basically, he went to Tenten's shop because he gets a huge discount just being her sensei. So he basically got a year's supply and then some of shuriken and kunai and stuff set up. So they were able to do that, and they agreed to that, and they agreed that he will do that about 3 times. So Team 10, and when it came to a good amount of their weapons, was basically covered. They knew that. So the money they were just making off a lot of these was just money that they could shove into their pockets. So they were saving. It was like, really? And very few people realize how wealthy that those 3 members came pretty quickly. They made about 3 years supply. They made about within 2 weeks. You might as well say they had made the income of an Ambo Black Ops captain. 2 years worth of missions and stuff, and plus little added bonuses and stuff just for that. So they weren't so worried about the money from the D ranks. They just did them just to do them. And because they were so efficient with them, the D ranks, they became known as a very popular team to be requested for a lot of stuff because they were efficient, they were good, they got it done in a timely manner. 8 was coming known to be a pretty good one. So, yeah. Team 7 was struggling because of Sasuke having a superiority complex. The inferiority complex was pretty much crushed, but the superiority was pretty much almost crushed by his parents. Then you have Kakashi, who was just giving him a little bit more special treatment than the rest of the team. When he dismissed the rest of the team, he kind of had Sasuke step back and give him one-on-one training sessions and showing him some stuff. So they basically, where everyone is at right now among the Genin teams, the newly minted ones at least, Team 10, they all know their chakra control exercises, and they were starting to do a little bit more for Choji and Hinata. Because Anko stressed chakra control when they were younger, with Uzumaki twins and Shikamaru, they had all these advanced chakra control techniques that they were actually teaching them, their team. So it was refining their chakra even more. And Asuma was quickly picked up on these training exercises and went in with these training exercises too with his team, because he wanted to be a good sensei by showing, just because he knows some stuff and the team might, there's some members of the team might know a little bit more, something else, doesn't mean just because he's the teacher he can't learn. So he was trying to show his philosophy that he passed on to his students is, you're never done learning. You're only done learning when you're dead. And even then, he's not 100% sure because he's never been dead before. So, and he says, I'm not trying to find out anytime soon. So what he's doing, he says, you just got to keep an open mind. Inspiration and learning sources, different stuff comes from different places. So he goes, we could all work on chakra control. Even, no matter what, even the Hokage can work on it. If there's something new, he can learn it. So he was learning these new chakra control exercises just as much as them. So he was. That was he was doing. He actually was willing to take different sources to help them out become. They came down with their own formations. They were working on a lot of those. So basically, how that was how it was. Team 8 learned a lot of their basic chakra control exercises, and Kuranai heard from Asuma that they were learning more advanced chakra control exercises. So that's what she was starting to do with them. She agreed with him, which she heard similar things from her friend Anko, that chakra, you can have the most chakra in the world. If you can't control it, what is it going to do for you? Kakashi has not even attempted the chakra control exercises, so his team is being literally left in the dust by the other two teams. They're advancing by leaps and bounds. Why? Because they're looking to guy who's helping all the teams with, and he's excited. He's not just, he didn't take it as a bad deal when Kuranai Asuma comes to him and say, "Hey, our type juice is not the best. Can your team come and help us with the taijutsu? We'll work with them too. You can run us through the paces to the ground too. We don't have a problem. We're trying to set up a good example for our team." They have this work ethic like you have, so he guy sat out there and goes, "Oh, the fuck, the power of you is so passionate, loving you." He goes on his tantrum that you know that about the power of youth and everything, his big crocodile anime tears, and he wholeheartedly believes. And he goes, "Oh my god, the camaraderie, the show, the your car math, yeah. Oh, we're gonna make this next generation strong as ever." And that was basically his flaw. He loved that. He didn't think he was adding more work. He didn't care if he was adding more work. He was just happy, and it was setting a good example for his team to be able to work with other teams. Because that could easily happen if he was, if they had went to war or something. So how it worked for every other day was either conditioning or for taijutsu. And basically, all three teams were ran into the ground with their taijutsu. And that got to the point it was about half the day, because when they realized Tenten was really good with weapons, she was helping them with their weapons, aiming and everything. So, which they were all working on their weapons, even the senseis. Which guy was in big tears every single time of the power of youth and the young leaflings and the older leaves are showing the camaraderie that you never stop learning, blah blah blah. Oh my god, he was just in tears, the big anime tears that. He will not fail this generation. He will do everything he can. If they don't, if he doesn't make it, he'll run around the village 500,000 times on his hands. And that worked out. And Neji quickly realized with Hinata, yes, her range was not as big as his. Well, her range was bigger than his, but her range was not as big as his, but her range, that's not what impressed him. He couldn't figure out why she was not considered the clan's prodigy, and he was, when she could see finer details than he couldn't. He actually had to work hard just to struggle just to get to that, see that small. He couldn't see small things like insects. She could, and she wasn't even trying. And she was getting to the point that she was training herself to see their networks and stuff. So he was impressed by just the mere size of it and stuff. So he thinks that close-up ability made up more about the range than anything, because he goes, you can have the range all you want to see the enemies coming, but if you can't see traps that they have set, even the slight chakra signature, you and your team just ran into a trap without even realizing it. So he was starting to think he was not truly the prodigy, but Hinata was. But seeing her as a younger sister, he couldn't be more proud of that fact. So he couldn't help it. This is one of the times where the team 9 was in the village. They were on a C-rank mission, so they weren't worried. By this point, we're gonna say it's been a month, and Team 8 has completed 39 missions, D-rank missions. Team 10 has basically has done 45. What was the big significance throughout the month is Ino was so tired most of the time between training, and her body's just hurting all the time because of the seals and stuff. She was just getting to the point she was mentally and physically just exhausted, and they only took one day off. And the D rank missions was felt like more of a break than the actual training. That she comes to realize that she was no longer thinking of Sasuke. She was just more or less figuring out how to make these seals a lot easier, so she can become. She realized she has to become stronger to make them easier. So she just it's just that. So she's more focused on that. She found out from Kurenai she has a knack for genjutsu, so she decided she was going to focus on that and stuff. So it's just it's coming together where just a good swift kick in the ass for Ino. She realizes she cannot be the fangirl. If this is as much work that she realized she might have not even put in half the work that actual Koichi, the series about her career, has done. She realized how out of shape she truly was, even before the resistance seals were placed on her. Even more so. So she gave up on her diet altogether and started eating more quantities, which thrilled her parents because now she's actually starting to think more like an actual shinobi than a fangirl, so they're actually enjoying that. And with Kurenai, she did show that she did not like fangirls whatsoever. So she was tough on the boys, but they quickly realized that she was way tougher on Kunai was way tougher on Ino. If Ino backtalked her about anything, she quickly learned within that 2 weeks. Kunai put her on a very scary new genjutsu, and here was it. She had to watch Sasuke die half a dozen times, or Sasuke was chasing her, trying to kill her. Let's just say the level of sadisticness just went up and up and up, and to the point that Ino just didn't mention Sasuke whatsoever. It was more focused on her ninja career than Sasuke. And she just realized she was just too tired to worry about it because she was being ran into the ground. If it wasn't for Kurenai and Asuma or Gai and her teammates running her into the ground, her papa ran her into the ground. He kept his word and he was going to step up her training. So he stepped it up. So she ended up being woken up at 4:30 in the morning, dragged out of bed. And so much so that he let her have time to get dressed and do her hair. She wasn't allowed to put on makeup. He took her makeup away. He actually had her mother go in and seal up all fairly girly things that away besides training gear and her shinobi gear. Anything that was more that it gave off the air of being civilian basically got sealed away and put away, saying, "You will earn this if you will earn this back when you can prove that you can think more like a shinobi." So with that, Hinata basically let's just say ended up moving out of the Hyuga compound. And it was just surprised by the lower branches. Hinata had found a apartment, and the apartment she was gonna originally go was in the bad part of town. Not the old leaf was not bad, but this one was pretty much on the somewhat the dangerous side of Leaf. And you know, when she heard about that from Ino that Hinata was gonna move there, he showed her a apartment above the flower shop that she can have. And he didn't charge her that much rent, probably about 100 Rio a month. And all she needed to do was pay about 200 or something. I'm not sure how yen. I'm not sure. I have to do the calculations. But it was coming down that he only had her pay about $50 for the apartment and then turn around and pay another $150. So it was about $200 a month for the utilities and stuff. So she had more than enough money for food, her ninja gear, and everything. So, yeah. It was actually quite shocking. She quickly moved out. Neji, not liking the fact that she moved out, found out that her place was a two-bedroom. Asked if she could move in with her. Hinata didn't have a problem, but being Ino's father, basically is the apartment manager, Hinata, out of respect, asked him. He said, "Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. If you feel more comfortable having a cousin with you, fine, go ahead. Actually embrace it." And just kept everything the same. So so Neji moved out. Shortly after he moved out, the birdcage seal was removed and the silent sun was placed. And he felt that it was the same, but yet he can tell it was different. He goes, "It didn't feel like it was restricting anything, but he can tell the same setup for the birdcage seal was on the silent sun seal, which was on both the wrist." And so it became quite evident the eyes were locked after death. How she explained it was the best way to protect the eyes and any other genetic codes when it came to this silent seal with this. After death, once the heart stops beating or the brain stops functioning, whatever stops first, the seal will activate and basically in a brilliant blue heated flame will actually destroy the whole body. So basically it's doing a quick cremation. And it should keep everything else around it, the surrounding areas, fine, but that's what it's doing. It's basically destroying everything, which means that no one has the time to get to the eyes. Because the first thing it will destroy is the eyes before basically destroys anything else. Bandaku heard about the silent seal, silent sun, and he commissioned the sealing masters to go ahead and place it on all the Uchihas. He's not risking another Uchiha defecting and somebody possibly getting their eyes. So he was first along with his wife, and they forced the Sasuke to get it. So they all had the silent seals placed on. So it made, with that on, they, with those seals on, made it incredibly difficult for anybody to take their eyes. And Fudaku has made it cited that it will be made a standard practice with any newborn to get the seals on within the first week of life. Just to make sure that the genetic code is protected, which will protect Leaf in the end. So, after the, so with that, that's where we're gonna be. The teams are getting frustrated with the D ranks. They're getting ran to the ground with their training. Team 10 and 8 don't mind, along with Team 9, they rather have be run into the ground because they know in the end it's going to benefit them. They rather get their asses kicked now than have their asses kicked on the battlefield. So that's their theory. The only team that's truly not being ran into the ground is Team 7. So, but only one member of Team 7 is truly taking his, not saying one member is truly taking his team training seriously. Sasuke is pretty serious about his training, but he has the help of Kakashi and his parents. But that one, but Kakashi is proving to be what everyone feared he was going to do. Only favored one person and ignored the others. So he is actually taking up training with Ibiki, which, let's just say, Ibiki is not holding back. He's running his ass to the ground and taking up the ideas and training styles from three of the teams that are already in active duty. So, with Hiei having the resistance seals on and basically getting knocked down, he's the only, technically, if you want to look at it, he could possibly be the strongest on the team outside Kakashi, but we're going to find out. So, we're going to leave this at this. If you hit the love like button, if I get 3 likes, I'll post another video. As promised, I'm gonna post another one today. So, all right, bye bye.